So I will speak about a problem in fracture mechanics. So it's not strictly related to thin films, but anyway, to some problem in materials science. In the last years, a lot of people working in the calculus of variations have started to work also on models of quasi-static crack growth, mainly for brittle cracks and in the case of elastic materials. So this happened after this seminal paper by Francfort and Marigold, which made clear what are the connections of this field with energy minimization problems. But most of these models are based on the idea that the crack is brittle, which means that there is no intermediate state between the crack and the elastic regime. And the other point is that the material is elastic, which means either linearly elastic or it obeys the rules of finite elasticity. Unfortunately, it is well known that in real materials, the crack front is usually surrounded by what is called the process zone, where in general there are plastic phenomena. And so it is clear that all models that neglect plasticity are just approximate models that can study the problem where these process zone can be in some sense neglected. And one should now study the real problem where there is interactions between cracks and plasticity. So study crack growth in elastoplastic materials. And so the first thing to do is to study what is the theory of quasi-static evolution for elastic, perfectly plastic materials. This is a theory that was developed in 1981 by Suquet. It is fully understood. There is an existence result. We know that the uniqueness is valid only for the stress, and that in general the plastic part is not unique. Together with De Simone and Mora, we revisited this paper and we found a new proof in the framework of this rate-independent evolution problems in the general theory of rate-independent evolution problems developed by Milke, and which was mentioned also in the previous talk. And some years ago, together with Rodica Toader, we developed also a model of crack growth in elastic, perfectly plastic materials. We obtained an existence results, but I have to say that the important properties of the solutions were not investigated and remained completely obscure. One question that, in my opinion, is of interest is the following one. Can the crack grow in a continuous way when crack growth happens in an elastoplastic material? Because we know that the answer is yes, if the growth happens in the crack problem is studied in a perfectly elastic material. But what happens in an elastoplastic material? Because the alternative would be that a crack grows in an intermittent way. There are jumps of the crack and then intervals of time where the crack stays constant. And so what I will do in this talk is to present a simplified model for the problem of crack growth in elastic, perfectly plastic material, where we can answer this question by proving a theorem. So in this simplified model, the answer will be the following one, that the crack growth is always jerky. So we always have that the crack is piecewise constant in time. And I decided to study this problem after a discussion with Kaushik Bhattacharya that happened this spring. He told me that he was studying some plastic problem where some crack growth problem in elastoplastic materials when there was there were composite materials with two components. And he considered just the numerical simulations, but what he obtained in his case, together with his collaborators, was that the crack growth is piecewise constant. So I wanted to understand whether in a simplification of our model, this is really something that can be obtained as a mathematical result. And so now I will explain what is the simplified model. So we have the model is in dimension 2, the reference configuration is a bounded connected open set, the boundary is assumed to be Lipschitz. We fix some part of the boundary mark with this D, which is the part where we prescribe the Dirichlet boundary conditions, which will be time dependent. In the rest, the condition will be the natural homogeneous Neumann boundary condition. So mechanically, this means that this part is traction free. And to simplify the problem, we consider the anti-plane case, so we have to work just with the scalars, and this will be very useful in our proof because we have to use several times the maximum principle and tools like that. And the main simplification is the following one. We assume that the cracks and also the plastic slips can occur just in a prescribed segment that connects two different points of the boundary, and for the rest is in the interior of the domain. And just to simplify the exposition, we can assume that this segment gamma is nothing but the intersection of omega with the x-axis, starting from some point with coordinate A to some point with coordinate B. And so this is the picture of what we are studying. There are some small technical assumptions that are very natural, that if I consider the part of omega which is in the upper half plane and in the part which is in the lower half plane, both are connected with Lipschitz boundary, and also that the part where we act with the Dirichlet condition has a non-trivial component in the upper part and in the lower part, because this is crucial for some estimates. So for the mathematical proof, it will be useful to have Poincaré inequality in some parts. So conditions at the boundary should be given on both sides. And so now I can describe more in detail what are the energies that play a role in this model, because this will be an energetic formulation of this quasi-static evolution in the framework of these rate-independent processes developed by Milke. So first of all, we said that there is no plastic part out of gamma, and so this means that the function U will belong to the solid space H1 in omega minus gamma, and the elastic energy will be simply given by the Dirichlet integral. Then, to describe what happens on gamma, I introduce this notation. Gamma S1, S2 is simply the segment between S1 and S2. And I assume that the crack is always of this form, AS, so it starts from A, from the left point, up to some point S, which is the coordinate of the crack tip. And the energy that is used to produce this crack will be just is proportional to S minus A, so the length of the crack, and I assume that the proportionality constant is 1 for in order to simplify the exposition. Then there is the plastic part. The plastic slip can occur only between S and B. And it will be determined by the jump of the function u, which is defined as the limit from above and the limit from below, the two traces on gamma. And now, in plasticity problems, it is important the notion of plastic dissipation distance. So in the case where the plasticity is diffuse, in these models, the plastic dissipation distance is given by a term like this, so the integral over the domain of the actual plastic part at the present moment and the plastic part, the plastic strain at a previous time. So this is the term that you find in the usual presentations where plasticity is diffused. Now, the plastic part is confined to this segment, so it is clear that the equivalent of this term will be given by this one, so where we compare, we take the difference between the jump at u and the jump at u0, which has to be considered as a previous time. So these are the energies. Now, in order to describe the model, I prefer to start with the discrete time formulation, which is easier to understand. So what we are doing now, there is time in some interval 0t. So at each time, we prescribe a boundary condition, a Dirichlet boundary condition on this part of the boundary, which could depend, must depend on time, otherwise nothing moves. And I assume some regularity with respect to time, absolutely continuous with respect to time. And so now in the discrete time formulation, I just consider a bunch of times between zero and t, and I describe how to pass from time ti minus one to time ti. This is done by solving this incremental minimum problem. So here we assume that we already know what happened at time ti minus one. So we already know what is ui minus one. We already know the value of the crack tip at I minus one. And then we minimize with respect to u. And assuming that u satisfies the updated boundary condition at time ui, and then this is the energy that we want to minimize, which is the sum of the elastic energy of the energy that you spend to produce new crack. Of course, here I should have written S minus Si minus 1. This is the new crack, but Si minus 1 is a constant, so I can omit it in this formula. And then also there is a term which is the energetic cost when you change the plastic strain, so if you change the opening in the remaining part. So something that plays role here is the fact that this is computed just starting from S, because in the other part you already have considered the energy that you spend to produce the crack. Well, so this is the discrete time formulation, but we are interested then in the continuous time formulation, that is the limit of this when the fineness of this subdivision tends to zero. And in our old paper, we proved that if you interpolate in the obvious way these discrete values, what you get, if the fineness of the subdivision tends to zero, is that these discrete solutions converge to a continuous time quasi-static evolution, and the properties that define this continuous time quasi-static evolution are given in this slide. Now what is given is the boundary value that depends on t, and the unknown is a pair, u, which is a function with values in h1, the displacement, and s, which is the location of the crack tip at time t. And so the properties that define this quasi-static evolution are, first of all, irreversibility of the crack process. So S is not decreasing. So once the crack is there, you cannot heal it in this model at least. Then there is an equilibrium condition. For every time u satisfies the correct boundary condition at its time, and if you consider the sum of the elastic energy and the crack energy at time t, this is less than what you would obtain if you take another function that satisfies this u hat, the same boundary condition, and then here you consider the elastic energy, the crack energy of this new function, also s can be changed, but it must be larger than s of t, and you have also to consider the contribution due to the plastic part. So this is, if you want, a strange minimum problem where the minimizer, which is the pair us, appears also on the right-hand side, because ut you see also here. But this is typical of this problem of quasi-static evolution. And then the last property is an energy dissipation inequality, where you see in the left-hand side I have the elastic energy at time t2. This is the amount of energy spent to produce the crack from t1 to t2. This is the difference in plasticity, and this should be less than the elastic energy at time t1 plus this integral. And after some easy integration by parts, you can interpret this as the work done by the external forces in the time t1, t2, in order to produce the boundary displacement that was imposed. And so this is the term that I will call later the external. The work of the external forces. Well, strictly speaking, in Milke's formulation, usually here you have an energy dissipation equality. We could have also here equality instead of inequality, but we have to define a notion of dissipation starting from these two terms. So this can be done, but now I have no time to explain how, because the definition is quite technical. And the point is that in order to deduce this piecewise constancy of S, what I need is just this inequality. So we can continue using that only this property. And so here is our theorem. In our theorem, we assume this condition, which is the standard one for this kind of quasi-static evolution, and in addition that this W is continuous with values in L infinity. So this is a slightly stronger condition. And the conclusion is that there exists finite number of, say, switching times, such that in a finite number of values for the location of the crack tip, such that if you are in the interval between tj minus 1 and tj, the crack tip is at sj. So this shows that the crack tip is piecewise constant. One could add that the other element of the solution, u of t, is piecewise continuous, in the sense that, but the difficult part is to prove this, once you know that s is constant in this interval, you can prove that the corresponding u of t is continuous in this interval. But then it will jump exactly at the jump points of s. And so now I don't want to enter too many details of the proof, but I want to give an idea of what can be a strategy to prove that something is piecewise constant. And so the starting point of the proof is to fix two times, and then I will call ui the u at ti, and wi, you just simplify just a little bit the notation. And the first step is we just play on the Euler equation that is due to the minimality conditions at T1 and T2. I play on the energy dissipation inequality between T1 and T2. This is a quite standard way, and then just adding what we get, we obtain this inequality. And now let me make some comment about this. The idea is that this term should disappear because the function here, since the boundary conditions are continuous in L infinity, by the maximum principle, this should be very small. And so this term should be absorbed in the next one. Now, some comments on the right-hand side. This one is the work done by the external forces between T1 and T2, which is expressed as an integral. The other term here is a sort of approximation of this integral, because you see, instead of u depending on t, I take just the half sum of the values of u at the endpoints of the interval. And then what remains is the integral of w dot, which is just the difference of the w of the endpoints. So this can be interpreted as a true integral minus its approximation. And you might imagine that this is very small, not only singularly, but also collectively when you sum a lot of these terms, because this is more or less the way you approximate an integral with a finite expression like Riemann sums or things like that. So this will play an important role here, so I will call it omega depending on T1 and T2. Then one technical point is that we can prove that there exists some small constant such that if the difference in times and the difference in the location of the crack tips is less than this delta zero, then the difference in the solutions is less than one. So this term is, in the worst case, minus one half S2 minus S1. And so this means that from this inequality, I get this one. Now, what I want to prove is that this is zero in some cases, because I want it to be... So I have to show that this will be so small that gives this term is zero. And so this is done by taking... when you take an interval, suppose that you can subdivide it into smaller intervals such that the condition... used before, so that both are less than delta zero, is satisfied for any two consecutive times. And then what you get is that you can apply the previous result to all these intervals, and so you get that here for the S, you get a telescopic sum, so what remains are just T2, tau2, star1, and then we have this sum here. Now the question is, how can we get this one? This is automatic if S is continuous, because if this is small, this must be small. But if it is not, we can have a real analysis argument which says that if all jumps of the function S are smaller than delta in this interval, then I can find an eta such that if the difference of if the difference of t here is less than eta zero, then also the difference of S is less than delta zero. Because in some sense, the worst it can do is a jump of order delta zero. So this is obtained by taking a decomposition of the function into its continuous part and its pure jump part. The pure jump part is under control because all jumps are less than delta zero, and the continuous part gives no additional jumps. And so now it is almost clear how to finish, because you take the set of times for which the jump is larger than delta zero. Since the function S is monotone, this set is necessarily finite. And now it is clear that if you take an interval such that it does not intersect this set F, then you can find a subdivision of this interval with the property that this inequality will be satisfied. And so what you get in the end is this. And now the theorem is proved if you can prove that you can make this as small as you want. And this is the part that is related to the approximation with Riemann integrals, because if you remember what is the definition of this omega, the difference between these two terms, you see that this sum will go to zero if the sum of this term will go to the integral, and the same if you have j minus 1 here. And this term here is not exactly the Riemann sum of this, but almost, with a very easy transformation, it can be reduced to a Riemann integral. And so now what we need is a result which says that when we have a Lebesgue integral, we can approximate it by Riemann sums. And this is fortunately a very old result that was proved more than 100 years ago at the beginning of Lebesgue integration theorem by Hahn, which says that if you take a function which is not Riemann integral but just Lebesgue integral, you can find a sequence of subdivisions, finer and finer, such that you have precisely what you want, that this integral will be the limit of the Riemann sums taking by evaluating f just at the left part of the integral or in the right part. So this theorem is already present, and what is strange, this is my personal comment, is that this is never considered in standard courses in measure theory. I have to say that I read the original proof, which unfortunately is in German. So I don't speak German, but I can read something. And also the mathematics underlying is quite complex. But I found a very elegant and elementary proof in the book by Dubo on stochastic processes, because the proof is just uses Fubini theorem. And the idea of the proof is the following, that what you can try is use the Riemann sum by taking just the equipartition. Maybe this does not work. Well, then you translate a little bit, and then you can prove that for almost every translation parameter, this subdivision is fine. And to prove this, you consider a double integral involving the... So this is very useful, and if you want, you can find a nice proof here. Now, final comments. When we finished the proof, we were worried about the following fact, that... all these results are compatible with the fact that the crack never moves. So this would be a disaster, because you prove a lot of properties, and then... And I have to say that, unfortunately, in a similar problem for dynamic crack evolution, this drawback appears. For instance, if you study the dynamic crack evolution in the case of viscoelastic materials, and if you use the Kelvin-Voigt model in viscoelasticity, then what happens is that the crack stops. This is known in the mechanical community as the viscoelastic paradox. This means that if you want to study dynamic in viscoelastic materials, you have to use a different model with respect to this. So what happens in our case? We found analytically some set, which will be a rectangle and so on, and a particular function W, where we say that at least there are two different values. But of course, also two different values not enough. So after that, together with Luca Eltai, we made some numerical computations. And these are the results. So this, you see, the rectangle, you act on the upper part and on the lower part. There is a sort of a profile that moves toward the right. This is the visualization, so the color code is the height of the function. And if I want to explain what is the rest, maybe I can pass to the next one. No? Now it seems, well, okay. But this is fine because I wanted to explain. This black part there is the plastic part. So where the two lips are still connected, and the crack is the part which is completely free. Now I see that there are some problems in the visualization. Let us try to pass to the next. Okay. Now there is. Oh, this is what happens just on gamma. So you see, the crack is in the left part of this black zone, and this is just moves by jumps, and the other tip is the end of the plastic zone, and this moves continuously, but then it jumps exactly where the other one jumps. And also you see that each time a jump occurs, the crack tip has some plastic part ahead, of course, but the jump was in the part that the jump stops in the part where the plastic part was not present before, but there is a simultaneous jump of the plastic part. And then if I'm able to... This is not a film, this is a static picture. This is a graph, horizontal is time and vertical is position. So the blue part is the crack tip, and then you observe that it is as it should be, and the orange part is the front of the plastic part, which moves continuously, jumps, and so on. So, just before the last slide, this is what happens if I increase the factor in front of the plastic part, which corresponds to the fact that I consider a plasticity problem with a much larger yield surface. And so, as you can imagine, when the radius of the yield surface tends to infinity, you can expect that the solutions converge to the solution without plasticity. We proved this, and this is the numerical evidence, because you have seen that here you don't see the plastic part, the jumps are more frequent and smaller. And so there is an approximation of... of the continuous regime by discontinuous. Okay, so I think that I can stop here. Thank you for your attention. The gap is infinite. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the point is that...
Which other kind of dissipation will let you use this intrigue? Not only...
I think, here, but probably this is something that can be common to other problems, because what happens here is that when you use the energy equality, you get an integral. If you use the Euler condition for the two endpoints of this interval, you get something that it is a sort of approximation of the integral. And so I think that this method could be used also for other similar problems in quasi-static evolution, essentially. The difficult part that was omitted in this presentation is to prove that this nasty term with an integral of the opening of the jump of the difference could be neglected. This is obtained by using the maximum principle. And this is exactly the point where, for the moment, we need the fact that U is a scalar, and we cannot repeat the same for the case of vectorial elasticity. And also, now we are trying to repeat the same proof, assuming only that the crack is confined, but the plastic part could be everywhere. But then the problem is not so easy, because if you confine also the plastic part, then out of this segment gamma, you have Laplace equation. And so you can use maximum principle as you want. Otherwise, out of gamma, you still have the quasi-static evolution for a plasticity problem. And then it is... we were unable for the moment to prove the L-infinity bound that is needed to repeat the same proof. But maybe there is another proof. We are working on that. Because now my program will be to try to get similar results, but without all these constraints, but just the constraint on the crack. And for the rest... because it seems from the numerical point of view that this should be true even if you don't put a constraint on the crack. But maybe from the mathematical point of view, the next step will be to consider a constraint of the crack, and then we hope for the best for the general case.
I guess we are a long way to not extracting part of the crack.
Yeah. No, this is not so important. It was important in a previous version of this proof, but not in the present one. Yeah, no, this is not important. But I think that what is still important is that the crack is just connected. So you cannot say just the crack is a subset of the proof would be much harder. I don't know if it can be reproduced.
Usually you have always stress concentration, and this is not the opposite. And if you have plasticity, you a priori bound the maximum, if it is perfect plasticity,
Yeah, you bound a priori stress. The point is that it is not clear if you can bound also the plastic part in such a way to have an L-infinity bound of the jump on this part. But yeah, maybe we can discuss, because probably, yeah, because fortunately the stress is automatically bounded in plasticity, this is clear. Yeah, but the point is that what we need is a sort of L-infinity bound for the solution depending on L-infinity estimate of the boundary conditions. This is no, no. No, here the stress is not bounded because the bound of the stress corresponds here to the bound of the normal derivative on gamma. Yeah, because you have effect of plasticity only there. And so when we study the problem, there are still singularities in the stress out of gamma, but they are under control. Yeah. Yeah, because if you want, this can be interpreted as a problem where you have a cohesive zone, but a very special type, and it is also localized. You prescribe that all processes should take place on gamma.